Water is a thirst-quenching threesome of two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom. And like a threesome, it can get complicated.
pH, ions, minerals, particulates, microorganisms, they all play a part in altering what is otherwise an uncomplicated substance. So here's a brief history of our understanding and how it pertains to today's topic. 1675, aquatic microbes were observed for the first time. 1834, the ion was postulated. 1854, confirmation that human waste and water don't go well together. Finally, it wasn't until 1909 that the concept of pH was introduced, and 1924 that it was defined with tangible measurements. And that's where we start today. The foundational element of brewing water is pH. You're probably familiar with it now more than ever because it's on every water bottle, or unintentionally if you fall on this side of the scale. At the right levels, it creates a suitable environment for malt enzyme conversion, hop acid extraction, and healthy fermentation. At the wrong levels, it stresses yeast, increases infection chance, and causes harsh flavors and instability in the final beer. Optimal brewing pH at various stages is somewhere between 5 and 5.6. Finishing pH is usually somewhere between 4.1 and 4.5, but it can go lower depending on the style. Ions are the next most important element, and there are a couple of key players. Calcium and carbonate balance pH. Sulfates increase hop character and bitterness. Chloride increases mouthfeel and sweetness. Magnesium is an essential yeast nutrient and is mostly provided by malt. Sodium contributes acidity, flavor, and mouthfeel. At high levels, it's poisonous to yeast and makes a beer harsh and salty, like Twitter. Ions individually can throw a beer off kilter if there's too much or too little. When done right together, they're a production crew. Critical, invisible, and they make the performers shine. Like many of you of a particular gender watching this, untreated water can be broken down into two main profiles, hard and soft. Hard water is alkaline with higher levels of calcium and magnesium. It works best to emphasize hoppier flavors, darker profiles, and a richer mouthfeel. Dublin Irish Dry Stout, Munich Dunkel and Doppelbock, and Dortmunder Export Lager are notable examples. Soft water is acidic with higher levels of sodium and potassium. It works best for lighter, crisper beer. Czech Pilsner is the most notable example of this. Styles we consider historic came from working with available water, but modern brewers aren't restricted. They can treat it, but they're not the first. We know from earlier that water hasn't always been clean. Brewing water is boiled, effectively sanitizing it. Beer provided safer hydration. You were less likely to get one of these baddies ruining your day. The downside was most people were operating at low to medium strength intoxication all the time. One chemical fixed the health problem, but was a major buzzkill for beer. Chlorine. It causes unwanted aromas and flavors and makes yeast's job very difficult. Chlorine gets addressed by heating brewing water to 148 to 158 degrees Fahrenheit, called strike temperature, which is a normal brewing step. Filtration takes care of the rest of the undesirables before that water hits the brew kettle. There are three main ways to filter water. Particle filtration is the most basic, trapping solids, large particles, hopes, and dreams. Carbon filtration is generally used alongside the former and catches everything else. Reverse osmosis is a multi-stage process that filters the incoming water to nearly pure H2O. It's the most thorough, expensive, and wasteful. After filtration, pH and ions are tweaked to emphasize the best aspects of the beer. It's the beer equivalent of finding your selfie angle.
Water isn't just an ingredient that makes up 90% of beer. It's an essential resource, and that's how we come to the wet blanket part of this video.
It takes an efficient brewery about 3 gallons of water and an inefficient one between 7 to 10 gallons to make 1 gallon of beer. Using California as an example, the total water used between nearly 1,100 breweries is 651 million gallons per year. Despite that scary number, brewing has been found to have little to no impact on California's drought. The most water-intensive part of beer is in hop and barley cultivation. Both are done in states that aren't a few bad summers away from becoming a Mad Max-style wasteland. In brewing itself, it's mostly in operations and processes like clean-in-place and packaging. Beer found that its members' water efficiency increased in small increments over time. Not that surprising from a group that's interested in reduction. Adjusting processes made up most of the efficiency increases, as outlined in this eye-wateringly dull but important manual by the Brewers Association. The takeaway is that beer will always use a lot of water, but it is getting more efficient.
The more extreme and eventually necessary end to a finite resource like water is recycling. Voluntary and encouraged today, but likely mandatory in the future. So why don't more breweries jump on this?
One hurdle is cost. It's expensive for startups just getting the ball rolling, and existing breweries won't see their return on investment for several years. There are breweries that have made this an integral part of their business, some in thorough or unique ways, and that list is likely to grow. The bigger hurdle is a lot of pee, politics and public perception. In my home state, there are no uniform health and safety standards for breweries and wineries to reuse their processed water on site, making the existing case-by-case administrative procedure to do so difficult and expensive. Progress is being made in the right direction, and we can expect broader adoption when the bureaucratic and cost barriers are lifted. For the second, some areas already recycle water from what's come out of people's unmentionables without much fuss. Outside of that, the reaction is a bit of a shit show. In the case of Budweiser, internet comedians made every possible piss water joke, despite that water never touching beer, while New Brew used exceptionally clean recycled sewage water in their beer. It was well received in blind tastings, but blasted by naysayers online. There is some promise, as willingness to accept recycled water is high through education and assurances of safety. In both areas, there's still a long way to go.
Water seems simple enough, but there's a lot going on beneath the surface. So the next time you're savoring a delicious beer, give water some credit. Beer is water, after all. Cheers, and thanks for watching.